हेलो। हाँ कृष्णा, आवाज आ रही मेरी? हेलो।
यस सर।
हाँ भूमि जी, आवाज में मेरी आवाज आ रही है? आवाज क्लियर
क्लियर
हेलो।
वॉइस क्लियर सर।
अच्छा ओके ठीक है।
हम सब दो तीन डिवाइस पे।
हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल टू यू?
यस मुकुल, ऑडिबल।
हेलो।
A very pleasant afternoon to one and all present here. My name is Mukul Singh, PhD Research Scholar at Department of Electrical Engineering, School of Engineering, Gautam Budh University. Thank you to each and every one of you for being here with us today. It is my great pleasure to welcome you all to our online one-week short-term course on the topic Emerging Trends in Power and Energy Systems, STC-ETPES 2020. To be organized from today, such that 24th of August to 28th of August 2020. I would specially like to welcome our chief patron, Professor Bhagwati Prakash.
Yes. Mukul.
Yes, sir.
Please wait for a minute. Dean sir is joining us.
Okay, sir.
We will inform you when to start.
Okay, sir.
विजय राजपूत जी, आप अपना प्लीज प्रेजेंटेशन हटा लीजिए, आपका डिस्प्ले हो गया है।
Gautam Buddha University was established by Uttar Pradesh Act 9 of 2002 at Greater Noida. Its first academic session commenced in August 2008 and it is fully funded by Noida and the Greater Noida Industrial Development Authority. The university is recognized by the University Grants Commission and is a member of the Association of Indian Universities. The university is also ISO 9001:2008 certified. Gautam Buddha University is evolving as one of the finest campuses with state-of-the-art infrastructure and intellectual resource. The university campus is an architectural marvel and spread over 511 acres with approximately 127 acres of green area. The university is situated at Yamuna Expressway. Moving straight from gate number 2, we find a beautiful Lord Buddha statue surrounded by a beautiful sarovar. Mahamaya Shanti Sarovar is spread over 1 lakh square feet area. The sarovar enhances the beauty of the whole university. Around the sarovar is Mahamaya Paripath. On the Paripath are located 8 schools of learning.
A very pleasant afternoon to one and all present here. My name is Mukul Singh, PhD Research Scholar at Department of Electrical Engineering, School of Engineering, Gautam Buddha University. Thank you to each and every one of you for being here with us today. It is my great pleasure to welcome you all to our online 1-week short-term course on the topic Emerging Trends in Power and Energy Systems, STC-ETPES 2020. To be organized from today, such that 24th of August to 28th of August 2020. I would specially like to welcome our Chief Patron, Professor Bhagwati Prakash Sharma, Honorable Vice Chancellor of our Gautam Buddha University. Also, I would like to welcome our patrons, Professor Shweta Anand, Dean of Academics, GBU, Professor P.K. Yadav, Dean, School of Engineering, GBU, and Dr. Nidhi Singh Pal, HOD, Department of Electrical Engineering, GBU. The conveners of the event are Dr. M.A. Ansari, Research Coordinator, School of Engineering, GBU, and Dr. Omvir Singh, EPPC Coordinator, School of Engineering, GBU. The event is organized by Electrical Power and Protection Club, EPPC, and TDEC, Department of Electrical Engineering, School of Engineering. Coming towards the objective of the event, why we are organizing such an event is because nowadays the power demand of various loads is higher than the power generation. And hence, it leads to power shortage. It is global phenomena, mostly in underdeveloped and developing nations. The increased power demand is not met by the conventional energy sources alone, due to continuous depletion of the conventional energy sources. Moreover, the conventional energy sources produce pollution, environmental effect, and ozone depletion. In view of this, on a large scale, there is a need for power generation through energy sources and aroused due to its huge availability and pollution-free operation. In the current era, computational intelligence and optimization techniques have been employed in various applications of power and energy systems for maximum power generation. This short-term course is aimed to provide an excellent platform for an in-depth discussion and interaction on advanced control techniques used for power and energy management. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Omvir Singh to give the welcome note and an insight about the event in detail.
Mukul, actually, I would like to invite Professor M.A. Ansari, sir, to welcome to all. Thank you, Ansari sir, please. M.A. Ansari sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Omi Singh, for giving me chance to speak on this occasion. Let me on the my camera. Hope the camera is on now. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bhagwati Prakash Sharma sir, Dean Academics, Professor Shweta Anand ma'am, Dean Research and Planning and Dean School of Engineering, Professor P.K. Yadav sir, HOD Electrical Engineering Department, Dr. Nidhi Singh Pal, Deans and HODs of various schools and departments, dignitaries of the Gautam Buddha University, and honorable speakers from various reputed institutions and universities, faculty members, volunteers, participants, and dear students, a very good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of the Department of Electrical Engineering, Gautam Buddha University, I warmly welcome you all to the inaugural ceremony of 1 week online short-term course on emerging trends in power and energy systems from August 24 to 28. Organized by the Department of Electrical Engineering, yes, School of Engineering, Gautam Buddha University, Greater Noida. I am sure that you will enjoy and learn a lot from the lectures of the galaxy of the renowned key speakers from various reputed universities and industry, and will be benefited from this short-term course on the emerging trends in power and energy systems. The efforts have been made to incorporate the recent emerging topics in the area of power and energy systems to cover the short-term course scope and the latest developments in the area of power and energy. And that is why we have tried to include the expert lectures of the renowned speakers from 12 institutions and the industry in this short-term course. To make it global, the speakers from abroad have also been invited to deliver the lectures. I am thankful to all the speakers for accepting our invitation and the participants to deliver expert lectures in this STC. Especially, we are thankful to the invited speakers, particularly Professor Anand Mohan, University of Minnesota, Minneapolis, USA, Professor Ashish Kumar Singh, IEEE Vice President, UP Section and Head of the Electrical Engineering Department, Motilal Nehru National Institute of Technology, Allahabad, Professor Celia Shehnaz, Bangladesh University of Engineering and Technology, Chair IEEE Bangladesh Section, Professor Prabhakar Tiwari, Madan Mohan Manvi, Technical University, Gorakhpur, Professor Iqbal Ali, Department of Electrical Engineering, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi, Dr. Yogesh Kumar Bikuria, Research and Innovative Labs, TCS Limited, Pune, Dr. Ranjan Kumar, NIT, Hamirpur, Dr. Navneet Kumar Singh, Motilal Nehru National Institute of Technology, Allahabad, Dr. Shailen Kumar Dwivedi, Maulana Azhar National Institute of Technology, Bhopal, Dr. Fahad Ilahi Bakhsh, NIT, Srinagar, Dr. Amrish Mishra, NIT, Patna, and Dr. Arjun Dev, Energy Institute, Bangalore, and other invited speakers. Once again, I welcome you all to this novel online gathering of 1 week short-term course on the emerging trends in power and engineering systems. Thank you all. Now I hand over to Dr. Omi Singh for further proceedings of the STC. Thank you and welcome you all.
Thank you, Ansari sir, for giving me this opportunity. I am the convener of this STC. So this STC topic is basically emerging trends in power and energy systems. So this SDP is basically for 1 week. And I have especially thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Bhagwati Prakash Sharma sir. He has given me the opportunity to conduct the program with the Professor Ansari sir and respected Dean Academy ma'am, Professor Shweta Anand ma'am, and Dean School of Engineering, Professor P.K. Yadav sir, and our Head of Electrical Engineering Department, Dr. Nidhi Singh Pal ma'am, and Registrar sir, and respected speakers, Professor Shailia Shehnaz ma'am and Dr. S.K. Dwivedi and other dignitaries, dear participants. And thanks to my colleagues, Dr. Ansari sir, Dr. Kirtipal and Dr. C. Vishkarma sir. Now it is a great pleasure to share program highlights here. So in this STC, we are going through a variety of research topics from power energy systems during this course by the help of 12 eminent speakers. So the names has been displayed by Dr. Ansari sir. So the topics I am just saying about, the topics which are covered in our STCs, combating climate change result in the resonance of electric power engineering. So that topic is covered by Professor Ned Mohan sir. And insights of energy systems, that is covered by Dr. Ashish sir. And application of electric network frequency of digital recordings for location stamp verification. This is covered by Shailia Shehnaz ma'am. And role of energy efficiency and conversation, that is covered by Professor P.K. Tiwari sir. And IEC 61850 based communication for smart grid, this is covered by Professor Iqbal Ali sir. He's from Jamia University. And prosumerism in distribution system, this is covered by Yogesh Kumar Bishpuria. And load forecasting, a tool for power system planning, this is covered by Dr. Navneet Kumar Singh. And grid interactive PVBS microgrid with improved power quality and seamless transfer capabilities, this is covered by Dr. S.K. Dwivedi ji. And a novel method for power system interconnection, this is covered by Dr. Farhad Ali Ilahi Vaksh. He is in NIT Srinagar. And role of electronics in power system, this is covered by Professor Ambrish Mishra ji. And development of solar water pumping system using brushless DC motor drive, and this is covered by Dr. Rajan Kumar. And the last topic is building integrated solar photovoltaic system. This is covered by Dr. Arjun Dev. He is from the Energy Institute, Bangalore. And so this STC would be beneficial for many disciplines of engineering and technology. It is of interest to serve teachers, industry persons, researchers, engineering students of different national and international institutes, and professionals working in the industries across the world. This event is mainly focused to share the knowledge of the various distinguished professors and professionals across the globe at single platform. So all the participants across the world may get benefit from this online event. So on the successful completion of this course, all participants would be awarded course completion certificate, e-certificate. So this STC is organized under the umbrella of Electric Power and Protection Club and also Techno Design Electronic Circuits Club of our Electrical Engineering Department, Gautam Buddha University. So now I would like to invite our respected Dean, Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir. So now I would like to invite our Dean Acad ma'am, Professor Shwetan ma'am, to share few words with us. Please, Shweta ma'am. Shwetan ma'am is not available, ma'am. Shweta ma'am, I think she is not.
Shweta ma'am. No, Shweta ma'am is here. She has joined.
Okay, Shweta ma'am, please. So,
yeah. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
VC sir will be addressing first, right?
Actually, sir, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. VC, ma'am. I think VC sir has not joined, ma'am. I think.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this STP. I would like to congratulate the organizers, OMVG and Ansari ji, for planning this under the guidance of their dean, Professor Pradeep Kumar Yadav ji. And the drive behind all these STPs and different events that we are continuously organizing in Gautam Buddha University our Vice Chancellor, Professor Bhagwati Prasad Sharmaji. He has really inspired us to do a lot of activities, webinars. We've also taken up a lot of funded projects from Government of India to do things will help ease out the situation of corona. Some of these projects are related to awareness creating projects. There are some where we are trying to build a kit where the testing of corona will become faster. So we are doing a lot of things basically as a contribution to the country to ease out the situation. For the benefit of all the delegates who have joined this STC for the first time at GBU, I would like to give a quick overview of Gautam Buddha University. As on date, it has become even more beautiful because of the rains. It is lush green and we have fruit trees all around bearing fruits. You must have seen that video at the start of this program which showcased the beauty of this university. So the next event, I am hopeful we will be planning it in the university and you will all be part of it. However, except for the ambience, which we will not be able to give to you in this STC, the organizers will make sure that the best of experts, and you can also see a lot of well-renowned experts from this area, part of the inaugural event also. So as this week unfolds, you will see a lot of discussion on power and energy and the latest trend, the impact on climate, the alternative energy, and a lot of interesting topics that they have lined up in the schedule for you. Okay, Gautam Buddha University, we started out in the year 2008. And when we started out, the first batch we had was only management students. So the first batch of management students passed out in 2010. So you can see we are a new kid on the block with less than 12 years under our belt. But then in 12 years, from having zero buildings on this campus, we now have more than 20 hostels, more than 10 academic buildings, a huge library, a beautiful administrative block, state-of-art sports facilities. We have the auditorium, which is huge. We can seat around 3,000 students one go. It's even beautiful than the one in Delhi, Vigyan Bhavan. So this university has actually grown like a tree in front of our eyes. The GBU faculty that you see here are the ones who have really been part of seeing it grow from a small seedling to a huge tree. We have all the disciplines now. So we started with management, but now then we added everything else, all possible disciplines. We have biotechnology, vocational sciences, we have engineering, all the disciplines of engineering, including architecture. We have School of ICT with computer science, IT, everything. We have School of Law, School of Humanities and Social Sciences, School of Buddhist Studies. So all the possible disciplines, having the best experienced faculty members. So our biggest strength is our faculty members who carry a lot of experience, and our minimum requirement at the time of recruitment is a PhD degree. So all our faculty members have a PhD degree and are well experienced with good exposure. Good high impact research is what they are always working on. And all that has converted into good NAC rating and a good 12B certification from the Government of India. Another strength that we have is our students. Our students have been really working very, very hard and have become a very strong alumni base now. So the first batch passed out in 2010, but now over the years, we find our alumni becoming strong, becoming globally placed in different countries, supporting and mentoring the juniors now. So that part has also taken off. Then our non-teaching infrastructure, the support system in terms of IT, library, administration, that again is always supporting. And you can see that even during this pandemic, we are doing a lot of these online activities along with the academics. The academics has also not taken a backseat. And in fact, the online classes that we have started for the academic year 2020-21, this started in July end. So we have not lost time and we have not delayed the session. We made sure that last year the exams took place, though it was in online mode, as per schedule. The admissions made sure that they did proctored online exam of the candidates, so they did not force them to go to the online center or to come for a physical pen paper exam. However, they did not compromise on the quality of the entrance exam, and they held the entrance exam also. It was called a proctored online exam. So admissions also had a lot of webinars, question answer session that they organized for students who were having doubts about what topic to pick up, parents had doubts. So admissions again made sure that there was no impact of the lockdown, and they efficiently are making sure that admissions is happening well. Examination also scheduled the exams in June itself, and the students were given training, mock tests before the actual exams. The results are also going to be published within a day or two. This academic session also has started since July end, and the classes are taking place in online mode. So we are using either Microsoft Teams or Google Class to do the same. So you can see that in the leadership of Professor Bhagwati Prasad Sharma ji, we've made sure that there is a change in the mode of how we do exams, admissions and classes. However, we have not compromised on the content or quality. In fact, in one of my class, I remember the students were saying that online class is even better for them because the internet is working well and we can share real-time videos, we can look up real-time the latest data analysis related to the topic. So we've not seen it as a disadvantage. In fact, we're trying to capitalize it. Another thing that we're doing right now in every school and department is doing a brainstorming session on how we can make this experience, the current experience and situation, as an advantage and turn it into an asset. So there are different discussions happening in different departments. And in fact, in one of the departments where I was participating, they said we are going to activate our student circles and motivate students to plan a lot of activities and a minimum of one activity in each circle per month. So that will really help them learn team management, organizing skills. It will help them reach out to experts in the field, talk to them, schedule a meeting and an expert lecture. So we are trying our best to make sure that despite the slowdown that's happening the world over because of Corona, we are not seeing any slowdown in our university. In fact, we are actually progressing, learning new tricks, learning new aspects of technology and using it as an advantage. So I would once again like to congratulate the organizers of this STC. It's a good initiative and I'm sure you will execute it very well and do a great job. I would like to congratulate all the participants for deciding to take part, and it's a good decision. It helps us rebuild our skill set in this time and it keeps us productively busy. So congratulations to everybody. I hand over to the convener, Dr. Omvi Singh.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. So giving us such type of information about our university system and other things. So now I am just inviting Professor Pradeep Kumar Yadav sir, our Dean School of Engineering. So Yadav sir, please give few words.
Well, friend, very good afternoon to all of you. Very, very distinguished Professor Sweta Anand, Dean Academics, Dr. Ombir Singh, Dr. Ansari, and very, very distinguished invitees and participants in this very program. I must say that Dr. Ombir Singh and Dr. Ansari They have taken a lot of pains to see to it that all the participants who are participating in this wonderful event, they come out with their best. They have been making efforts since long, and today it is going to be culminated. Now, Professor Anand, she has already shared many things about the university, and there is not much left for me except that, you see, power and energy, they are two very, very vital parts of any economy, whether Indian economy or any other economy, whether developed economy or developing economy or underdeveloped economy. You see, everything goes in such a way that each and every stage the power is used. Energy in different forms. I'm delighted to say that many of our distinguished faculty members, they are working on different modes of energy. They are into research about solar energy and so many other alternative forms of energy. Of course, they are working on it, but then hydro energy and other, they are all conventional means. The new one they are trying to explore. And these days, you also find that the vehicles, they are going to be electrically vibrant. So in the process, the energy itself, you have to draw from various sources. And you see, you take any case of missiles or rockets or satellites, everything works on energy, one form or the other. So I must congratulate the organizers of this seminar for picking up a very timely subject to explore upon, to discuss. So this is again an opportunity for all the participants who are distinguished in their own field to share their views and experiences. Of course, without taking much of the time, I wish this program all the best. And I hope and trust that whatever aspirations with which the conveners came out with this event, they will definitely achieved over the course of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your kind words. Now moving on to the first lecture by Professor Celia Sehnaz, ma'am, on the topic application of electrical network frequency of digital recordings for location stamp verification. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you for the invitation. Let me share my screen. Can you remove the screen if you are sharing so that I can get the opportunity to share the screen?
Yeah, ma'am, I have removed.
Okay. So let me take a few minutes. It's coming. Can you see it? Hello.
Yes, ma'am. It is visible.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for the kind invitation. This is an online one-week short-term course, but actually it is a great effort, I should say, considering the pandemic situation, for advancing the technology through the pandemic situation. I thank Dr. Ansari, Dr. Amrish Singh, especially the supportive administration from the deans and vice chancellor, and especially all the faculty members, participants of the Gautam Buddha University. It's a great honor to share the knowledge. Actually, I work in an interdisciplinary field. I basically work with machine learning and pattern recognition. And I try to apply machine learning and pattern recognition in different fields. So today's topic is very interesting in a sense it covers a multidisciplinary area. So location identification using power and audio data based on temporal variation of electrical network frequency and its harmonics. This is just a brief bio of myself. If you look at my membership, actually, I'm the founder of 4 technical society chapters in my section, signal processing, robotics and automation, industrial applications, societal social implications. Apart from it, I work in engineering, medicine, biology, and also power and energy society. All are very much interdisciplinary and interconnected. I'm serving around 20 years, and among the 20 years, more than 18 years as an IEEE volunteer. And I'm serving as a member of IEEE New Initiative Committee. It is a global IEEE committee. I will request you. In engineering senior member elevation drive, because it's not only women, men, we are all having more than 10 years academic experience, professional experience, but many of you, we do not know how to apply for it. So please feel free to connect with me if you need any recommendation, any support, and any mentoring for senior member elevation drive. I'm a senior member of IEEE, and I was the founder of Side Group Flash. It is very much related to power and energy, special interest group on humanitarian technology. Later on, I served as a communication chair of Global Sites Steering Committee, and currently I'm serving as a chair Women in Site Working Group. And I serve as a Power and Energy Society Women in Power Region 10 representative that has provided me an opportunity to connect with many power and energy society experts in whole Asia Pacific region. I was the founder of Women in Engineering Chair in Bangladesh. Then I served as a Women in Engineering Chair of whole Asia Pacific, and then Chair of Women in Engineering Workshop of the Global Women in Engineering Committee. And currently I'm serving as a first female chair of IEEE Bangladesh section. It gives me a great opportunity to connect with different experts like you, and then collaborate with many of them and explore the potential. Actually, this is those two pictures. It represents the power of networking and innovative ideas behind me. PES Day celebration, every year it is in April, and IEEE Day celebration, it is every year in October. You know, these are the network led by me, involving students, graduate students, faculty members, entrepreneurs, industry expert, our executive committee members, our advisors, and many other industry people. And it is a strong connectivity, which is very important to utilize for global level research, no matter where you're living. And whenever we are doing any research in the area of power and energy or any other area, it is very important for us to connect with one of the UN Sustainable Development Goals, such as no poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water, like this. Because, you know, our research should not be for privileged person like me. I should consider myself privileged because my grandfather was a lawyer in Kolkata. in the British era. So actually, that's why whenever I do any research, I try to connect whether the research is serving the billions of people or serving a big cause. This is important. I request all of you to Google my Google Scholar citation. This is very important. You may have, our Dean Madam has said there are a lot of internet facility, but you know, sometimes we may have problem with the research computational facility. We may have limitations of the research funding. But if you look at my citation curve, 2013 to 2020, always the curve is almost increasing. That gives you hope that no matter what are your limitations, because we are living in India, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Pakistan, you know, Nepal, there will be always limitation. But despite the limitations, our research topic should be like that, so that it can be useful for others and it can be cited by others. This is a very important, I should say, let me tell that it is a guideline from my part to the young researchers to act accordingly, so that your research can be cited by others. That means it has impact on others. So this is actually one of the research work, highly cited research work, is although it is 285 in my original Google Scholar profile, and these are some papers that is published in IEEE Transaction on Audio Speech and Language Processing, and this is also a paper published in Audio Transaction Audio Speech and Language Processing, and every time the papers are cited by others, that gives us a very good feeling and good drive. So let us concentrate on the electric network frequency, how the knowledge of signal processing, machine learning can be employed for a very interesting work. Now, electrical network frequency actually is the supply frequency of power distribution grids, which has nominal value of 50 hertz in most part of the world, or 60 hertz in North America. So it can be defined as a set point frequency plus minus a deviation between the instantaneous frequency and the set point frequency. And actually this deviation varies from plus minus 0.05 hertz to 0.2 hertz. So F0 actually that set point frequency, and F actually the electrical network frequency. So actually the ENF data extracted from power grids vary due to difference between power demand and supply in various locations. It happens for the same grid. And a question is how ENF is captured. You know, digital audio recorders that are plugged into the power mains or are located near a power source can capture the ENF signal. This is due to interference from electromagnetic fields originating from power sources or acoustic hums and mechanical vibration produced by electrical power devices. So these are the two reasons that actually creates the ENF signal. And another important thing is that we need to really understand that how these digital recorders can contain the ENF. You know, ENF that is contained within a digital record can work as a location fingerprint. Very important. It is useful for security application. ENF variations hold some very recognizable patterns of a specific grid, because the variations are considered to be uniform for a particular grid, and variations are separable from grid to grid observation due to different degrees of control mechanism used to control load imbalance in respective network. But for the same grid, there may be minor differences which can be observed in different locations of the same grid due to the cyclic pattern of power demand and supply. This is very important. That means when you will get a digital record, audio record, the ENFs can be ENFs can be similar, but there should be some difference at sea, that it can be due to power demand and supply. But when ENF from two grid, the of course that will be different, because different control mechanisms are used to control the load imbalance or in the respective network. You know, this is very important, because you know, if you record a data, like you record a data staying towards the grid, and you have another data you have recorded close to another grid. So within the record, your ENF pattern will be always there. So based on the ENF pattern, you can really understand that near which grid this file or this audio data is recorded, and that will help you to identify location of the person who has given the audio data. So that's why ENF can serve as a location fingerprint, because whenever we are going to the airport, actually we give our fingerprint to as our identity. So similarly, ENF can give us a identity, like a fingerprint identity of the location, and that location is embedded within the ENF, and ENF is embedded with the recorded audio data. So actually, whenever any audio data is circulated with sources unknown to you, then you can analyze the ENF power network frequency within the audio data to find that from which location it can come. So there are previous research work that I have actually shown here. Actually, new research area, actually I should say, it is mainly focused on accurate estimation of electrical network frequency from power data. The ENF signal captured in audio recording exhibits a high correlation with ENF captured from the power mains, which leads to the authentication of the time of recording and also location of recording. So ENF is mainly used for forensic application, audio authentication, tampering detection. And also recently, very few researchers have developed a machine learning framework that explores differences among ENF signal in different countries and estimate the geographic location. Since there are very few researchers are doing, we thought that why don't we do it? It will be an emerging area for us in the area of power and energy, because we are trying to find the geographic location or grid position. Using ENF to find the location of grid is really a challenging task due to absence of adequate database. This is the greatest challenge that we have also faced in our research. To identify the grid location, various approaches were presented, like histogram-based features, multi-stage support vector machine classifier, entropy-based confidence measurement, and different things. And we need to really know that how this ENF looks like. No, it is the x-axis number of samples and y-axis is the amplitude. And it shows grid A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, and I. And you can see from visual observation that each grid has different ENF, electrical network frequency pattern. That means from this pattern, since you can do it visually, and though our purpose to do it automatically so that there is no error from the visual observation. But with this visual observation will give you a confidence that grid to grid the pattern varies. So since the pattern is varied, So it can be really captured, the difference can be really captured through a machine learning technique or a deep learning technique if more data are available. So what we have done actually, we have employed a root music algorithm. So we have extracted the ENF and its harmonics. Usually ENF is a fundamental frequency. Since I have a transaction paper of pitch estimation and fundamental frequency estimation, I have exploited that knowledge of fundamental frequency and its harmonic. And then we decompose the ENF and its harmonics into slow and fast varying components. And then we obtain sufficient statistical features from the decomposed signals. And then we apply the classifier to identify the region of recording on a publicly available power and audio data set. So this is the overall picture. And we solve it by using the root music algorithm. And this is the database, publicly database, actually power recording from 9 different countries. This is a huge task because we are not handling 2 classes, that whether it is grid EA or grid B. No, we are handling 9 different classes by a unique feature. That's why this is a challenging classification task. Signal length from 6 to 8 hours of recording. We have used a sampling frequency 1 kilohertz, and there are difference in original grid frequency. 360 hertz grid, and the named was A, C, and I, and rest of the other contain 50 hertz signals. So that our research contains the frequency variation of the almost whole world. Okay, so that we can we can tell that our research is not very confined. It covers electrical grid networks of many countries. So actually for ENF extraction, we employed the root music algorithm. And you know, for such algorithm, there is always a parametric and non-parametric approach. But you know, non-parametric approach is very easy to compute it, but it has a problem of accuracy. So that's why we went to spectrum-based method that we call root music algorithm. And actually, it is a it has different approach because it provides higher frequency resolution in analyzing ENF function. Not only that, the subspace-based methods like music or S-spirit algorithms are proved to be very effective for the ENF signals, in which dynamic range of frequency fluctuation is quite small. Actually, in frequency fluctuation, dynamic scale is small, and that's why we found that this music and S-spirit algorithm are very effective for finding the ENF signal. So modified music algorithm, that means root music algorithm, is used for accurate estimation of ENF signal with the increase of temporal resolution. This is very important, and also we have reduced the computational power. Currently, existing techniques extract ENF only in the base frequency, nominal frequency, whereas ENF is also present in the integer multiples of base frequency. This is found in our reference 9. That's why we are motivated to use not or an audio data so that we can find those properly. This is the ENF harmonics plot, and like the previous plot where we have shown the ENF, which was distinguishably ENF, ENF, we will decompose into slow and fast varying components. And once we decompose into slow and fast varying components, then we will extract the features and train the classifier. and they use a model to detect the grid location. This is a simplified machine learning structure for us, and it is important that how we decompose the ENF signal. Actually, it has been observed. Also, if you can see in the ENF signal, it has slowly varying component and fast moving component. So based on our, and also it is true for harmonics of ENF, it has slowly varying component and fast varying component. And based on our observation, we found that there are two different segments in an ENF. One is less variable portion, which predominantly shows very low resolution of change. It is we referred as LF, low frequency. The other segment is very highly fluctuating and varies considerably. So ENF signal actually composed of two parts. One, three, because we know the ENF, because that we have extracted from the root music algorithm. Now question is how we will find the low frequency component and high frequency component. You know, we can find the local frequency component easily, and then from the ENF signal, if we deduct it, so we can easily find the high frequency component, so that we don't need to find the high frequency component separately. So once we have the ENF and harmonics of ENF, and then we find the low frequency component and high frequency component of ENF and harmonics of ENF, then we come up with the feature, proposal of the feature. Actually, for this, we need to consider the subsystem. What is our subsystem? We have used both power and audio data. For power, we have considered 50 Hertz and 60 Hertz. And also for audio data, we have considered 50 Hertz and 60 Hertz. Now, if you consider the subsystem power data, we can see that we have taken feature for ENF, low frequency ENF wave from length, mean of entropy of high frequency ENF, peak factor of the ENF. These are the actually data we have used for the power data. Now comes to audio data. We have taken signal power of high frequency, high component ENF, AR parameter, I should say, because our this type of signals where there are peaks and delays, it can be represented by the pole and zero of the DSP, digital signal processing system. Since it has peak, it can be modeled by all pole or autoregressive model. That's why we have calculated of LF ENF. We can see the features proposed for audio data and feature proposed for power data are different based on their intrinsic characteristics. Not only that, we have also shown the formula for calculation of this feature. This is our actually feature vectors for our subsystem, including power and audio data. And once we have the feature, like other machine learning algorithm, we feed them to the classifier. There are, actually, we started with a complicated support vector machine, but you know, for different support vector machine, we have actually exploited different kernel function to detect and to find the accuracy. The different kernels were linear SVM, quadratic SVM, medium Gaussian SVM, and finally we can found that even compared to the cubic SVM, the medium Gaussian SVM and quadratic SVM gives the better result. This is the finding of our investigation. And we can compare that previously only ENF is used to detect the grid location. But in our case, not only ENF, we also use the features of low frequency and high frequency ENF. So you can see for power data and audio data of different frequency that we have used for training system, accuracy using the original ENF is lower compared to the accuracy using the decomposed ENF that has been shown in the right column. And we analyze the harmonic components of the ENF as well, incorporating the ENF. So previously, it was using original ENF, and then it is decomposed ENF. Here we have shown accuracy with ENF and accuracy with harmonics. And we can see that compared to the accuracy of ENF, accuracy with harmonics increases. And that gives us a motivation that why we have used the harmonics of ENF. And this is actually overall accuracy of the existing method. And we should say the comparison method and the proposed method for different our test samples for subsystems. So we can see that overall accuracy for 50 hertz power is 88.67%. For 60 hertz power, it is 100%. And for 50 hertz audio, it is 72.2%. And for 60 hertz audio, it is 77.7%. That means we can see the variation of subsystem when we are using power and audio data. And this is actually the confusion matrix. That means the y-axis is the true class and x-axis is the predicted class. And we can see that majority cases, we can when B class is tested and predicted class is also 100% for B. But in case of D, when D is tested, in some cases it is predicted as F. So this is a confusion matrix for 50 hertz grid, and this is very understandable. And also in cases of E grid, when it is tested, in some cases, 33% of the cases, it is detected as a D grid. And that's the overall reason of reducing the accuracy for 50 hertz grid when we are handling the data. Now you come to the 60 hertz grid. You see, when A class is detected and 100% times A class is detected. So that means for 60 hertz grid, it gives you a data and that tendency of having better result for 60 hertz grid. This is our actually conclusion. And for results and analysis, we can have some summary that if we decompose the electrical network frequency, it will improve the accuracy as shown in the result. And if we use the features of ENF harmonics, it also increases more. So at first, the decision is that we have to decompose the ENF, and then we have also used the harmonics of ENF to have better accuracy. So detection accuracy is less in audio data due to the low signal to noise ratio that we call SNR. And detection accuracy is more for power data. So detection accuracy of 60 hertz grid is higher than 50 hertz grid. It can be concluded that in North American countries, the fluctuation of electrical network frequency is less random. That's why it is giving 60 hertz. 60 hertz grid with a better accuracy. So that will give us an identity when the audio data will be recorded from North America, and when we will get such frequency with less randomness, then it will give us an idea that audio data was recorded and in a grid inside North America. So that is a very important identification problem for us. And these are the references we have used for our research. And actually it is a lot of forensic application for using power data. hope it will open up a new opportunity for the young research who are working in the power and energy system. And let me give you some idea that how our power and energy area can connect it to the humanitarian technology, because now the COVID lockdown situation is going on, and we are sure that we are not the first responders. First responders are the doctors. We are the second level responders. So by technology, we can help the people using our power and energy knowledge, such as non-polluting lighting, heating, cooking methods, technologies for clean water and sanitation, off-grid electricity generation like solar or bicycle, agricultural technologies like irrigation methods, you know, healthcare technology, ensuring power and energy for healthcare technology is very important. And also like Bangladesh, we had a lot of sufferings regarding flood. And that's why I'm very much interested to develop shelters with appropriate technologies for better protection against disaster and energy crisis. You know, these are very important where we can exploit our power and energy knowledge. And this is actually, since I work in site, this is actually IEEE site. I will request all of you, these are IEEE philanthropic programs. I will request all of you to visit IEEE site Facebook page, IEEE site website, IEEE site newsletter, because there are a lot of funding opportunities. Also, there is a humanitarian activity committee. From $20,000 to $60,000 they fund. Now question is, what are the areas we will look into? According to IEEE Test in News, which is a newsletter, a newsletter in the area of power and energy, supported by IEEE Power and Energy Society, we need to know the what are the factors controlling the future trends in PES. One is energy storage and integration of renewables. Another is distribution generation, hybrid model of grid. Another is data-driven technologies and cybersecurity. You can clearly understand that I'm focusing on the third area. So that's a motivation for the younger generation. We really need to know the future trends in an area, then concentrate in one of the areas the way I concentrated with my students. These are some knowledge about how we can utilize renewables. Since we want to connect with the humanity by humanitarian technology, you see, power energy can be used to
Ma'am, your voice is not audible.
Hello.
I think the connection is just broken down. Ma'am, will be right back. Just wait a bit longer.
मैम विल जॉइन सून, शायद डिस्कनेक्ट हो गई है शायद, तो भी ज्वाइन करेंगे मैम आपको।
हाँ ओमिर जी, हेलो।
यस सर।
5 मिनट का ब्रेक दे देते हैं क्योंकि वी जस्ट सेशन गोइंग 5, जब तक मैं कांटेक्ट करता हूं कि आखिर ये डिस्कनेक्ट हो गया।
यस। और नेक्स्ट टॉक विल बी 4:45।
हाँ ये अखिलेश जी आईआईटी बीएचयू से आ रहा है, ये क्या है?
कोई नो इशू। So the next talk,
let me call her and see.
हाँ, wait कर लेते हैं sir, wait कर लेते हैं। जी।
तो ऐसा करिए, 5 मिनट का ब्रेक अप है, सब लोग अपना जो है लेटर से just 5 minutes ब्रेक उसके।
Okay. मुकुल?
Yes sir.
The view from the top depicts these as 8 petals of the lotus. Each school of learning in the university combines a multilateral confluence of academic training, research, innovation, and creativity. They practice an interdisciplinary approach in teaching and learning process. Let us move on to the Mahamaya Paripath in an anti-clockwise direction. Here comes the School of Engineering. The school offers innovative and interdisciplinary programs complemented by experiential learning in the real-world situation. Its world-class labs allow students to combine classroom learning and exposure to the industry to understand current trends in their field of interest and expertise. The school is enriched by civil engineering, electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, and architecture and regional planning department. The next school is the School of Vocational Studies and Applied Sciences. This school comprises of primary disciplines of chemistry, mathematics, physics, environment science, and food processing and technology. Moving forward on Paripath, we find the School of Biotechnology. The school is famous for its state-of-the-art laboratories. The school aims at strengthening the academic and research programs and to undertake the sponsored research projects and consultancy from different agencies working in the discipline. The next school is the School of Management. This school is like a feather in the crown of Gautam Buddha University. Its 5-year program caters to a pool of electives in the areas of finance, marketing, etc. The school has state-of-the-art classrooms equipped with computing and multimedia facilities, supported by innovative teaching style by brilliant faculty members. The school promotes diversity in MBA class by inculcating students from different schools of the university. The school has many live labs, computer labs, professional development lab, and communication lab. Moving forward, we have School of ICT. This school offers information and communication technology related courses such as
Welcome ma'am. I think there was some network issue that we are all facing. Now, welcome ma'am. All the participants now, Professor Seela Shehnaz has again joined. Now,
yes.
Ma'am, you can continue, ma'am.
Okay. So let me share the screen. You can see it, right?
Yeah, it is there. So you can continue from the same place where you disconnected.
I was not aware from where I was disconnected. Can you tell me this is the slide or this is the slide? This I have shown?
No, previous one.
Previous one?
Yeah, go previous one more. Yes, you are here.
Yes, you are there.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay, so actually, that's why before starting the research for the young generation, we need to know what are the factors that control the future trends in power and energy society? So energy storage, integration of renewables, distributed generation and hybrid model of grid, data-driven technologies and cybersecurity. And you can clearly understand that I'm focusing on the third, data-driven and technology and cybersecurity, which is very important and emerging areas. And let me show you that how we can utilize our renewables, and you can see that our knowledge can be used to drive water from the well in the rural community, solar panel and windmill in the farming, and the solar panel can be used for the irrigation. Now, since IEEE Smart City Initiatives is very much connected to the power and energy society, so our knowledge of data management can be used for home automation, lighting, office automation, remote maintenance, security and surveillance, digital media center, car parking management system. So these are the areas where we can focus, and also these are some alternative energy utilization. You can see how alternative energy can be used. And also this is the time when you can think about that how you can apply for Power and Energy Society and Humanitarian Activity Committee funding to ensure lighting for the rural community. And this is our knowledge of Power and Energy Society is very important. That means lighting the humanity. And we can do such activity in our involving our graduate and undergrad students so that our knowledge can be employed to the community. And also this is the women empowerment where girl students are trained to develop or build solar panels so that it can be deployed to every rural home for ensuring at least study table, and also for deployment in the community clinic for preserving the insulin. These are very important concept. We must think our research how to connect with the community. And this is I was talking about the health, right? And the community clinic. You see, this is the Georgia Tech student in USA. They have done a funded project to give power to the people to the remote Haitian health center. Okay, this is very important for us to know, and we can actually inspire ourselves to do such. And I serve in IEEE Smart Village and in South Asian Working Group, and I will request you to search for IEEE Smart Village and see how you can utilize their opportunity to support, to give energy to the schools, fans, TV, clean water, agriculture, street lights. This is very, very important so that we can create impact on many people through our research. And this is actually from Bangladesh by the Global Funded Event, you know, because many of our routes, although we are developing, we are moving in a very faster progress, but you know, there are many roads where the normal ambulance cannot go, normal rickshaws cannot go. So these need-based and solar-based ambulance and carrying and rickshaw is very much important and a good application of the power and energy. And also, I think Delhi is, so far I remember, Mumbai has the Arabian Sea, but you know, Bay of Bengal, we have Bay of Bengal, and it is from Madras. It is a global site-funded event, you know. These people are having, the fishermen having many days living in the sea. They need solar energy. They can utilize solar energy to have their connectivity, to drive their engine. Not only that, if the situation and culture permits, then when they bring the fishes, we can empower women by providing a solar-based vehicle so that they can vendor the fishes. And such a way we can actually give our knowledge to the rural community. Now it is a COVID-19 situation. Let us do something where we can develop the automatic hand sanitizer where you will need the different power devices. And not only that, this hand sanitizer is not only useful during the COVID, after the COVID, they can be, Gautam Buddha University can take a lead for deploying thousands of automatic hand sanitizer developed during the pandemic situation to the rural schools where they have no soap at least. And let me share some of my contributions for conveying and spreading research for the community. It is the Region 10 Asia Pacific Flagship Conference, Humanitarian Technology Conference. It was organized by Bangladesh. It was awarded to Bangladesh by a bidding process. And I was the general co-chair. More than 700 participants were there. And power and energy was one of the major focus in that conference. And this is also Humanitarian Technology Conference where I ran a Women in Engineering track to empower more women with projects to advance sustainable green technologies for humanities. This is another related area to power energy, IEEE SSIT, Society on Social Implications on Technology. I have shown you that how I will apply the machine learning for grid stamp verification. But we usually never analyze the implications of such technology in the local community. This is actually the SSIT flagship conference ISTAS, where I organized a Women in Engineering panel because I really wanted to know what the people in USA, people in Australia are thinking and what are the projects they are working involving power and energy so that I can bring those initiatives in Bangladesh and in Region 10 countries. And not only the Region 10 Humanitarian Technology Conference, I work with Region Global Humanitarian Technology Conference. Every year it is in San Jose, USA, where I ran a Women in Engineering panel. I wanted to connect with the power and energy and other related discipline women working in Canada, Region 7, and USA is from Region 1 to Region 6, and bring back those good practices to our countries so that we don't need to replicate, we don't need to reinvent the same wheel. This is the Women in Engineering Conference in the area of electrical and computer engineering. For the first time in the world, I was the founder, where power and energy and many research, IEEE Power and Energy Society past president, Professor Saiprawan Rahman was there, Industrial Application Society president, then president, David was there. So, you know, I always like resource allocation. So next year we collaborate between Bangladesh section and Pune section for 2016, and then Bangladesh section and Uttar Pradesh section, Bangladesh section and Thailand section, Bangladesh section and Bangalore section. I had a dream to collaborate with universities in Delhi, but this pandemic came and Delhi is organizing IndyCon. So hopefully next year, next some other time, so that we can utilize this huge global network for the development of the Gautam Buddha University. Already Gautam Buddha University is very accomplished, but still by connecting with such research and innovation activities, it can actually help the students and faculty development can be more faster. And this is actually a global Women in Engineering Leadership Summit, where actually apart from the leadership, we trained our women for nuclear power energy education, because our government is investing much funding for nuclear energy and nuclear plant implementations. That's why it is important to train our men and women for nuclear power energy, which is an emerging area. So these are initiatives. Actually, it is a collaboration between Section and Industrial Application Society chapter, IEEE PIACON, for which I was the founder, and it was a global IS technical co-sponsored event. So it is a information for Gautam Buddha University that you can collaborate with Industrial Application Society and can organize your conference to develop your faculties, to develop your students. They will provide all support. And these are the different symposium. My question is, why I did it? Actually, I am serving as a professor in a Bangladesh University of Engineering Technology. That is the highest ranked engineering university in the country. But you know, my students, they do not have any facility. I have the facility to visit home, and you can see Professor Saifur Rahman, Power and Energy Society past president, and he regularly trained in many parts of India and many parts of Nepal and other countries, you know. But you know, I have the opportunity to meet them, but my faculty members, young faculty, they do not have the opportunity. So that's why we invite all. Now everything we do virtually also, we did virtually, so that our students and our faculty members can connect with these speakers, they can find a good PhD application, PhD admission, and can find good postdoc. And industry collaboration is very important for us wherever, in the power and energy or any area. Because if you see, that's why in your workshop also, you have invited many industry people. Because we really need to know what are the industry standard, what are the industry needs. And also, our Global Humanitarian Activity Committee has huge fund. You can apply for it the way we did Women to Women Empowerment Challenge, where women were requested to find one problem of Bangladesh faced by women and provide its technological solution using their power and energy knowledge, your robotics knowledge, your industrial application society knowledge. And our mentors and everybody guided them so that their project can be transformed into product, which is very important so that they can launch social entrepreneurship. You know, not everybody will be academician like me. Let me humbly explain. If you read my bio, apart from many best paper awards in the technical research papers, I received many awards for contributing to the community. 2013 Women in Engineering Professional Volunteer Award from Asia Pacific. 2015 Women in Engineering Inspiring Member Award from Global Women in Engineering. 2016 MGA Leadership Award. 2019 Regent and Humanitarian Activities Outstanding Volunteer Award. So actually, this is not the award list. Actually, this is a commitment list for me, that what I did. This is the Women in Engineering Professional Group and Women in Engineering Student Runs, for which I was the founder. And both of them actually became the best in the region 10 and became best in the whole world because of designing many women and the technical and research related activities, such as Week on EC that I have showed you. This is the 25-year celebration banner I have received as the first female chair of IEEE Bangladesh section. That has increased my commitment for designing more technical and research workshop activities that you are doing. And I ran more than 130 or 150 events. And finally, in 160 countries, there are more than 330 sections when we have received the 2018 IEEE MG Outstanding Large Section Award. Is a great honor to drive my section, and it is a great honor to receive all awards from the 2019 IEEE President Jose Mura, 2020 IEEE President Toshi Fukuda, current Regent and Director Akinori Nishihara, past Director Kuzin, and the future director Deepak Mathurji. So I'm also telling, although I'm working in Power and Energy Society, but I'm currently the chair of EMBS. And in 2020, we have received 2020 IEEE EMBS Regional Outstanding Chapter Award. Only two chapters in the world have received it. One is in Latin America, another in Bangladesh. It's a huge honor for us. This is an example. The way Gautam Buddha University is doing, the same way if they move in the power and energy also, they can also, in collaboration with Delhi section, can win such awards all the time. So this is the, I should say, the highest professional challenge in my life, IEEE Tenzin. This is the Region 10 Flagship Conference 2020. I was the general chair, and you can see that power and energy played a major role in our conference. Huge paper, around 200 papers wherein power and energy and power electronics and related discipline. And we had more than 1,000 submission, and it was more than all previous 10 SIM. But as a general chair, it was a great honor to drive the team to organize it during the pandemic situation. And it was the first virtual, fully virtual regent and flagship conference. It is not only a history for Bangladesh, it is a history for whole region 10. And it inspired many conference organizers for timely dissemination of research. As Dean Madam was telling that we should not sit and we should progress in research. For TenSIM 2020 has played a major role for many conferences to declare online afterwards. And I have seen many people are very worried, and that's why to train and to help the Region 10 conference organizers, I led virtual conference organizers panel to explore the challenges of organizing a full virtual conference. There was around 300 people who joined it to discuss the challenges and possible solutions in a full virtual conference. And finally, we did International COVID Congress, where there are many ideas related to power and energy, related to industrial application, related to signal processing, but everything related to COVID. Intensive inauguration also, we had IEEE President Toshio Fukuda as the chief guest, and also in International COVID-19 Congress. This is the first ever COVID-19 Congress in the whole world. And also Professor Toshi was the chief guest, and Professor Srinivas Singh, who is the Region 10 Vice Chair Technical Activities and India Council Chair, was also present. And it was a great honor to mobilize all students, young professional women in engineering members, signal processing expert, power and energy expert, industrial application society expert, to think about how they can explore research and innovation, how they can overcome the challenges during COVID-19. Many new innovative ideas, and many volunteers and many researchers who are really doing very hard work, their voices were heard, and it was a good platform to exchange research and knowledge sharing during the COVID. So actually, I really want to thank you for your patience. I like to share a very core fundamental research using the machine learning, and we are waiting for a big data to apply deep learning there. Then I really emphasize the way you are organizing the workshop. I tried to emphasize that what new initiatives I have taken, and you can also take in collaboration, so that we can actually explore research and innovation and convey this whole connectivity to others. And for your kind information, I'm actually running as a Region 10 director elect candidate. And there are three more candidates. One are from Dr. Supavedi from Thailand, Dr. Nuliza from Malaysia, Dr. Lance Frank from Australia. But I request you to visit my website, www.celiashahnaj.com, to know about my research, to know about my accomplishment, to know about my contribution. And please let me know how I can connect with you and how I can help you. It is very important, this pandemic, because we really do not know when the pandemic will be over. So it is important to connect virtually and help each other, so that we don't need to reinvent the same wheel, and we can mobilize the research and innovation for a better future. And the most important thing, that whenever any opportunity was given to me for student branch, or student branch technical chapter, or for women in engineering, or for young professional, or for section, or for region, or for globe, I tried my level best, no matter where I am living. I tried my level best to do and make my contribution well documented. I think I'm ready to serve all of you and to collaborate all of you for a better goal in Region 10. And thank you for organizing such a wonderful workshop. And bringing together so many scholars together for the students and faculty members' development. Hope it is a milestone for Gautam Buddha University, and it will act as an inspiration for the future generation, young faculty members who can help Dr. Amrish Singh and Dr. Ansari in future for developing more workshop like that. So with that said, I like to thank you, and I should tell you that we must work together to change the world because we are engineers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am, for your so informative lecture and your exemplary presentation. If anyone have any query related to the topic delivered or related to the IEEE or the various societies here talked about, so we have had 5 minutes of the discussion session. So if any audience from the group want to have any doubts, clearance, please ask.
Yes, feel free to ask, and I will be happy to respond. And if you have no question, you can connect with me later, no problem.
Yes, I think nowadays the networking is one of the biggest tools. Ma'am, I would like to request you, please just in the chat box, put your web link which you are talking. So okay. That if you want, they may have separate query to you.
Okay.
And sure. Be good. Related to IEEE, any help, if anyone wants, she will be ready. Because I know her, she is very helping and very extending support always from her side.
So this is my website, and you can www.CaliaShahnaz.com, and please visit. And most important, just search in the Google and write Google Scholar citations of Celia Shahnaz, so that you can get to know about my papers and let me know that how we can collaborate. Maybe we are applying deep learning, you are applying it for different signals, and we can come up with the common ideas, and we can solve the problem in a better way.
So thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for your time and your knowledgeable lecture and information. Definitely in future we will be collaborating, and we will be having many things in collaboration, because you are the center of IEEE, and definitely Asia region, region 10 is going to be benefited from your experience, your expertise, your knowledge, your capabilities. So thank you, ma'am. Once again, from the Gautam Buddha University for eternity, we thank you for delivering this lecture and giving your time. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for joining us, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Omvir, for taking the pain for arranging this webinar. I'm really grateful. And I request every faculty members and students here to convey my message to all, and let us work together. If you are not an IEEE member, no problem. You can connect your friends who are IEEE members.
Ma'am, we are having also IEEE branch also here, ma'am. I do Delhi section branch in our university,
yes.
Ma'am.
Yes, I know. Yes. So Omir, please inspire everyone, Dr. Ansari, inspire everyone so that they can connect with me. I'm ready to help, you know. We can do it better together. Thank you.
Sure, ma'am. Sure. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Take care. Saying goodbye.
Bye.
Stay safe.
Our second lecture.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Our second lecture will be taken by Dr. Shailendra Kumar on the topic.
Mukul,
after 10 minutes.
Mukul.
Yes, sir.
Just wait. Dr. Kishan will tell about the speaker.
Thank you very much for the valuable words, ma'am. Now, our next speaker is Dr. Shailendra Kumar Dwivedi. He has completed his M.Tech and Ph.D. from IIT Delhi After that, he has completed his postdoc research fellow at Khalifa University Petroleum Institute at Abu Dhabi. After that, he joined as Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel National Institute of Technology, Surat. Now, he has joined MA National Institute of Technology, Bhopal. He is young and very good researcher. He has received Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology Assistantship from Government of India during his PhD. He has also awarded best paper in UPCon 2016 at IIT BHU and UPCon 2018 and at Triple M UT Gorakhpur. I welcome Dr. Shailendra Kumar Dwivedi to please enlighten us with to please share your valuable words and research.
Thank you so much, and thank you for the nice introduction. And I would like to also thank to the Professor Ansari sir as well as Professor and Dr. Om B. Singh to provide me opportunity to give a means little one-hour talk in this particular STTP. So I'm going to share my slides. My voice is audible or not?
Yes, sir, audible, sir.
Yes, sir, audible. Okay, so I'm going to share my slide, then we'll proceed.
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah.
हाँ रावत जी, अरे मैं कह रहा था यार लड़का भेजूंगा तो आधा पौन घंटा लग जाए, मैं तुम्हारी मेल आईडी पे कर दूँ।
Yeah, so slides are visible. Are you able to see my slides?
Yes.
Sir,
again, thank you so much for providing
me. Sir, screen is visible, slide is not visible.
Okay.
You have to share your PPT slide.
Yeah, I shared, but actually,
डॉक्टर शैलेन दोबारा से आप है ना लॉग इन करिए आप तो तब शेयर करिए शायद प्रॉब्लम रिजॉल्व हो जाए।
ओके ओके सर।
Sir, your mic is muted. Please unmute yourself.
No?
Yes, sir. Slide is not visible. Sir, you are presenting the window, sir.
Sir, after opening the PPT, go to present and then on the single tab, just click on the PPT. After opening the PPT.
Same. I am doing same. So I went to the present now, your window, but
not window, sir. Let me check, sir. Yeah.
Dr. Dwivedi, can you send email us? We can share.
email the PPT, Dr. Omid Singh will share it. Please email the PPT, Dr. Omid Singh, he will share it.
Okay. Sir, first open the PPT, then minimize it. Then if you will share, then it will.
Yeah, same. I am doing, means I opened just the PPT. Why? I mean, these PPT are not visible when I'm going to share a window. So it should be visible on that particular point. Only two things are there, HTTP.
Maybe actually, please you exit from the session and again join the session, then maybe your problem is resolved. Just you exit from the session. Yeah. Yeah, now it is okay, visible. But it's a very small size, I don't know why it is so small.
Unmute
sir, can you please
sir.
Make it full screen, I think. Yeah, make it full screen, then it will be size okay.
Unmute yourself, sir. Unmute yourself, sir.
Yeah, now it is okay?
Yes, sir, it is perfectly fine.
Yeah. So, thank you very much. And now, sorry for the delay, actually. And now, topic of my presentation is grid interactive photovoltaic battery energy storage based microgrid with improved power quality and seamless transfer capabilities. So as this particular STTP is focusing on research trend, or we can say emerging trend on power energy system. So here, what is the task in this particular system? We have extracted the maximum energy from the PV array, and how we can utilize this particular energy to charge the battery, as well as we can also transfer this particular power to the utility grid. So this is a small system. This is a domestic, the application of this particular microgrid is for domestic use. Like we have many non-linear load, as well as we have battery storage for backup in our home. So these things, keeping in mind, this system has been designed and as well as experimentally verified. So as I told that lots of nonlinear load are connected at point of common coupling. So they inject the harmonics. So we have also addressed this particular, we have also addressed the power quality issues in this particular system. And if we target the rural area, so in rural area, what happens? There is fluctuation in the grid. Means there is various sags, well, that like if we start the large induction motor, so there is a voltage sag, and when we switched off the capacitor load, then there is a swell in the voltage. As well as we also experience the outage of utility at that particular areas, rural area. So this system has been designed for seamless transfer operation. like if there is means on and off utility grids, this system should operate at that particular moment. Because we know that if there are emergency loads, if means we have hospitals, data centers, if we means some doctors are doing experiment and we lost the electricity grid, that that is not feasible for that particular moment. So this microgrid will provide the uninterrupted power to these loads even at outage of utility grid. So let me discuss the motivation and objective behind this particular work. So as we know that recently MNRE has taken several steps to abandon of diesel engine, because like city like Delhi means due to pollution we cannot afford this kind of diesel engine. So when there is outage of utility grid, then people start means to get the power, they start the diesel engine and all of that. So these things are very dangerous for humankind. Already air pollution, we know the situation of air pollution in Delhi. So we cannot afford these diesel engine to lighten our home or to get the electricity. So so therefore, to avoid these diesel engines, an energy storage is required to avoid the outage of utility. So the PV array with battery storage and grid synchronization and desynchronization solution for a residential area. So another task or another important feature of this particular system, if we consider a conventional solar inverter. So if we talk about conventional solar inverter, so what is the mandatory condition in that particular solar inverter? We need grid. Means if grid outage is there, then the solar inverter means cannot utilize. So we need to shut down these particular solar inverters. So at that moment, we lost the power across the emergency load. As I told, the data centers and the hospital require continuous power supply. So if we lost the grid, then the control in such a way so that we need to, if we lost the grid, then we need to shut down that particular system. No other option. So so these particular means things we have keep in mind and design this particular system. So in this particular microgrid system, extracted active power is shared between load and utility. Moreover, the microgrid can operate under outage of PV source and utility grid, where in turn increase in utilization factor of PVPS. One more thing in conventional solar inverter, at night time when PV is not there, so again we need to shut down that particular system. If it is a simple PV grid connected system, so happen the utilization factor of that particular inverter is, however, if we connect the load and control that particular voltage source converter in such a way so that in daytime when PV is available, we can extract maximum power and inject it to the utility grid. However, night time it can operate as a compensating device. Compensating device means as we have nonlinear load at point of common coupling, it can mitigate the harmonics which is injected by the utility grid. So clean power means the sinusoidal power is extracted or supplied to the load, and grid currents and grid voltages are maintained basically sinusoidal. So the utilization factor of this particular or payback period of this power converter is also enhanced. Another benefits of this particular proposed system: reduction in distribution losses. So we are injecting power at the load end. It is not means the inverter and load as well as grid is very close. It is not very far away. Another point: enhanced utilization of installed distribution equipment, bidirectional power flow capability. So whenever we have active source like battery or some renewable energy source, so if generation is larger than the load demand, then it can inject power to the utility grid. If generation is lower than the load demand, then we can also draw power from the utility grid if battery SOC is not in the particular limit. Like it should be, if you want to just discharge the battery, then SOC should be in 20% to 90%. Okay, so this system has bidirectional power flow capability. We can import power to the utility grid and export power from the utility grid. No need of bulky magnetic transformer. I will show the system configuration where we can see we are using battery cell transformer. However, in conventional battery storage system, people are using magnetic high frequency magnetic transformer to boost the voltage or to bring that particular battery voltage to the level of DC voltage. So here, but here in this particular system, we are using a bidirectional power, means purely power electronics converter, which means boost that particular voltage to the DC level. Now, solar PV can directly couple to the battery as well as this particular system using static transfer switches. So we to the utility side, we are also using a static transfer switches to connect and disconnect the utility grid, and as well as to enhance the synchronization time. So if you are using a relay, then it will take 5 to 6 seconds because relay will send the signal to the circuit breaker to disconnect or connect according to the situation. However, we have to provide just one pulse to these particular switches and your grid will be disconnected. So it is the time of these switches in microsecond. So the synchronization time and desynchronization time are also reduced. Now, performance verification and the point of common coupling voltage variation. We are also, there is indirect cost reduction by reducing losses and minimizing tripping. And another important feature of this particular system, using PV feed forward loop in current control mode gives a novel power distribution concept. So in this particular, if you are using PV feed forward down, then the dynamic response of this particular system is improved. So these are the classification of solar photovoltaic battery energy storage with microgrid system. So this particular system is divided into basic two parts. So we can, depending on the single phase and three phase. Further, these have been divided into three. If we talk about single phase, then single stage, two stage. For PV array, we are using a boost converter for MPPT purpose only. We are not boosting the voltage as boost converter has only 1 degree of freedom. And a single stage can be further divided into battery-less and battery-based. And further, means similarly for three-phase three-wire. And further, this three-phase system is also divided into three-phase three-wire as well as three-phase four-wire, where some industry offers mixed kind of load. So this three-phase system is not suitable for these kind of load. If we have mixed kind of load, means we have single-phase as well as three-phase load. So there is load unbalancing in that particular system. So what happened at that moment, large neutral current is injected to the utility grid. So by this, proposing this three-phase four-wire converter, we are able to mitigate the neutral grid current zero by injecting opposite neutral current by the voltage source converter. Means opposite neutral current to the load. So the grid neutral current should be zero, and this three-phase four-wire further divided into various. Here I am considering for a conventional two-stage single-phase grid-tied PV inverter. So here you can see we have solar PV array, and as I told, this boost converter has only 1 degree of freedom. So it can either it can boost the voltage or it can do the MPPT. So here what happens, we are selecting this boost converter for MPPT purpose. Keep in mind, this boost converter is not, means people are saying that no, this boost converter is used for boosting the voltage. No, why? As boost converter has only 1 degree of freedom, one, and second, we are keeping this particular voltage across the solar PV array and the voltage across the DC link is same. So that the losses, because if voltage difference should be there, there will be huge current in this particular circuit. So if the voltages are same, then the losses in the inductor and as well as switches are minimized. After that, this PV inverter means convert this particular DC power to the AC and inject it to the utility. But in this particular conventional system, this solar inverter works when in daytime only. If renewable energy source or insulation is not there, we need to shut down this PV inverter. Otherwise, this PV inverter will draw some reactive power as well as it will not inject the in phase we can say grid voltage and grid current, so it will draw some reactive power. And at that moment, we need to shut down this particular system. So utilization factor, keep in mind, utilization factor of this inverter will be reduced. for this particular system, so they are changing the control to control this topology. What they did, they have connected a load across or at the point of common ground. When controlling in this particular inverter in such a way so that in daytime it works as a grid solar inverter, grid tied solar inverter. In night time, when solar inverter is not available, they compensate the load only. Means they draw the power to feed the load or to meet the load demand, they draw the power from the utility. However, when generation is there, renewable energy generation there, they keep the extra power to the grid as well as they fulfill the load demand. But in this particular system, so the particular system are here, load is not connected, and load is, in this particular system, load is connected. And control is also play a major role in this particular system. We are controlling in such a way this system so that it can feed the power to the load as well as works as a compensatory unit. But further, what are the demerit of this particular system? As I told in introduction, so when there is failure at the utility side, so again we need to shut down this particular system. So again the utilization factor comes into the picture, and the utilization factor is reduced of this particular system. So with this next, so I have proposed this particular system. This is my PhD work. So I proposed this particular system to enhance the utilization factor of this particular system, or we can say solar PV battery energy storage based microgrid system. So what I modified in that particular solar inverter, I have taken a battery energy storage, and I have taken here, you can see static transfer switches, STS. I have connected a STS, so it, these are the back-to-back power switches or power electronic switches. So here when utility is there, so these means STS, so obviously we have to design another control. So we have designed a synchronization and desynchronization control. The output of these controls, 1 or 0. So according to utility parameters, so we know that IEEE 1547. So IEEE 1547 says that when the parameter of these utility parameter of this system are in the they have actually given the some limitation, or they have given some specification. Like if utility parameter are in this particular range, then you are able to connect the your converter with the utility grid. So if these parameters, so if these parameters are within the limit, then STS get one signal, and utility grid is connected with the converter. And if you have solar PV generation more than the load demand, because here load is also there, you can see non-linear load is there. So load is more, means generation is more than the load demand, the rest of the power can be sent to the utility grid. Now, if utility parameter are not, suppose fault occurs at the utility side, at that moment, STS got zero signal and the utility is disconnected. At that particular point, means the power which is generated from the solar PV array is used for the battery charging as well as to supply the non-linear load. So demand of non-linear load as well as we are charging the battery. So here we are using the bidirectional converter to control the charging and discharging, because more than 90% as means associated there, so more than 90% we cannot charge the battery. So so this kind of topology I have proposed and got one IEEE transaction. So by modifying and by also is this converter, earlier this particular converter was controlled in current control mode, but here in voltage control mode we have to generate the frequency because if utility is there, then this utility has well established 50 hertz frequency. But when we are going to feed the load, so we have to generate the frequency reference. So in voltage control mode, we are going to generate the frequency response so that we are able to, we can generate the 50 hertz sinusoidal voltage across the load. So this converter is also controlling voltage control mode when utility is not there or grid is not there. Now, design of this system. So, those who want to work in this particular field, so this slide is very important. Design of boost inductor, how we are going to design the boost inductor by considering 10% ripple in the PV current, then buck boost inductor, battery size, then DC link capacitor. So, DC link capacitor around 2500 microfarad is selected. Then ripple filter to mitigate the switching harmonics and damping or oscillation in the grid voltages. DC link voltage is selected around 400 because we are designing for 230 volt grid. So DC link is selected around 400 volt, and then discharging and charging capacitor, charging elements of battery stores. Now control of this particular system. So as we know that we have to control this particular system in current control as well as in voltage control mode. So in current control mode, we are sensing load current and unit templates, UP. So unit template is derived with the help of grid voltages. And by modeling this particular equation in MATLAB, we are able to derive the net active component of this particular load current. So this is nothing but DC, a constant, and it has been subsected with the PV feed forward loop. In the introduction, I told how we are utilizing this PV feed forward loop. So with the help of solar PV array parameter, as well as with the help of grid parameter, we are designing this PV feed forward loop, and the net active power is, apart from the load, we are subtracting this particular component with the load component so that the net power is injected to the utility grid. And depending on the battery, depending on the SOC of the battery, we are also giving the battery contribution. Means we need to charge the battery or we need to discharge the battery at that particular time. After that, again, net active component of load is, or we can say grid is derived, and this net active power component is multiplied with the unit template to derive the net reference current, which is compared further with the sensed new grid current to generate the error, and which is given to the hysteresis controller to generate